From New York, this is Democracy Now!
People are really scared. They're terrified. Most people have isolated themselves in a self-imposed lockdown. They are not stepping out unnecessarily, and the roads are all empty.
India is in a state of crisis as COVID cases surge and hospitals run out of oxygen. India just set a new global record with 315,000 new cases in a single day. We'll go to Mumbai for the latest. Plus, we speak with a Texas doctor at Baylor University who's working with an Indian company to develop a low-cost COVID vaccine. And it's Earth Day, as President Biden hosts a virtual international climate summit of about 40 global leaders. We'll look at the Red Deal, an indigenous plan to save the planet.
Unapologetically indigenous and anti-imperialist, the Red Deal is a political program to divest from fossil fuels and corporate polluters, to end military occupations, to abolish the police and prisons, and for indigenous people's land back.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. India is in a state of crisis as COVID-19 cases surge and hospitals run out of oxygen. India recorded 315,000 new infections Thursday, the highest daily caseload reported by any country since the start of the pandemic. India also reported its highest daily death toll with 2,100 fatalities. Hospitals in New Delhi and other cities have run out of oxygen. Workers at crematoria report they are overwhelmed.
Every day I handled around 30 to 40 bodies of COVID victims. A few days ago, my health wasn't good and the workload was too much. And I fainted three times here while handling the dead bodies.
In Latin America, Uruguay and Colombia are reporting record deaths this week. Brazil's averaging over 3,000 deaths a day. Argentina just passed 60,000 deaths in a year. Argentina's health minister called this week the worst moment of the pandemic. In Turkey, health ministry data suggests about 1% of the working-age population, or more than a half million people, currently has an active COVID-19 infection. Turkish officials have so far delivered about 20 million vaccine doses nationwide for a population of over 80 million people. The United States reported another 63,000 coronavirus cases and over 800 COVID deaths Wednesday, as the White House says it's reached a goal of administering 200 million vaccine doses within President Biden's first 100 days. The pace of U.S. vaccinations has begun to slow, with an 11% drop in a weekly rolling average. Polls show about one in four U.S. residents might not get vaccinated. On Wednesday, President Biden urged U.S. employers to provide paid time off for workers to receive vaccines and time to recover from any side effects. The U.S. Justice Department has opened a civil investigation into whether the Minneapolis Police Department has engaged in a pattern or practice of unconstitutional or unlawful policing. Attorney General Merrick Garland announced the probe Wednesday, one day after former Minneapolis police officer Derek Chauvin was found guilty of murdering George Floyd.
Yesterday's verdict in the state criminal trial does not address potentially systemic policing issues in Minneapolis. The investigation I am announcing today will assess whether the Minneapolis Police Department engages in a pattern or practice of using excessive force, including during protests.
The probe is separate from a federal criminal investigation into whether Derek Chauvin violated George Floyd's civil rights. The Minnesota Department of Corrections reports Derek Chauvin is being held in solitary confinement 23 hours a day at the Oak Park Heights prison, where he's being held ahead of a sentencing hearing in June. A prison spokesperson said Chauvin will be kept away from other prisoners out of concern for his safety. Family and friends gathered Wednesday for a public viewing of the body of Dante Wright, the 20-year-old black father fatally shot by a white police officer during a traffic stop in the Minneapolis suburb of Brooklyn Center. Reverend Al Sharpton is delivering the eulogy at Wright's funeral in a Minneapolis church today. This comes as Minnesota state lawmakers are considering legislation that would end qualified immunity for officers, place limits on when police can stop drivers, require the speedy release of body camera footage in officer-involved shootings, and strengthen civilian oversight of police. In North Carolina, protesters took to the streets of Elizabeth City overnight, demanding the release of body camera footage showing the police killing of Andrew Brown, a 42-year-old black father. Police have not revealed details of the shooting, though an eyewitness said Brown was fired on multiple times while trying to drive away from officers. This is Keith Rivers, president of the local NAACP chapter.
People are feeling tired, people are frustrated, and people want this to stop. And the only way it's going to stop is if we first have transparency, because transparency brings about trust. And when you have trust, then we can move forward in the march and the fight for justice.
In Columbus, Ohio, hundreds of protesters staged sit-ins and marched on police headquarters Wednesday to protest the police killing of 16-year-old Micaiah Bryant. Authorities have released body camera video of Tuesday's killing. The disturbing footage appears to show Bryant swinging a knife at two people as an officer arrives on the scene. The officer fires four shots at the girl, killing her. Authorities identified the officer as Nicholas Reardon, who joined the Columbus Police Force in 2019 after serving in the U.S. Air National Guard, where he received an expert marksman badge. Republican lawmakers around the country continue to push bills cracking down on protests. Legislators in Oklahoma and Iowa passed bills giving immunity to drivers who hit demonstrators with their cars. Meanwhile, a Florida nonprofit Wednesday sued Florida Governor Ron DeSantis after he signed sweeping so-called anti-riot legislation. Among other things, the law bars local governments from cutting police budgets without state approval and raises penalties on demonstrators accused of a crime, including damage to historical monuments or statues. Over 80 anti-protest bills in at least 34 states have been introduced this year, over twice as many than in any other year. The European Union has announced plans to cut carbon emissions by 55% compared to 1990 levels by the end of the decade. Environmental groups say the plan fails to meet the challenge of the climate crisis and is not in line with the Paris Agreement's ambition of limiting global temperature rise to 1.5 degrees Celsius. The White House is hosting a virtual summit on the climate crisis today, which is Earth Day, with 40 leaders representing the world's major economies, including China. Ahead of the summit, President Biden announced plans to unwind Trump-era rules that prevented California from adopting its own more stringent auto efficiency standards. He also pledged the U.S. will cut greenhouse gas emissions by at least 50% below 2005 levels by the end of the decade. Environmental groups criticized Biden's pledge as inadequate. Food and Water Watch said in a statement, quote, "As the world's historical largest emitter of climate pollution, we have a duty to do much more and to act with greater urgency." Meanwhile, Mexican President Andrés Manuel López Obrador will propose a migration agreement at this week's climate summit. The proposal would see Central American asylum seekers and Mexican nationals granted a six-month U.S. work visa and a possible path to citizenship if they spend 3 years planting trees and crops across Mexico. An internal investigation by the U.S. Capitol Police into the deadly January 6 insurrection has found that just ahead of the riot, an officer directed all units to be on the lookout for anti-Trump protesters, not the pro-Trump insurrectionists who went on to attack Congress. The revelation came in a congressional hearing Wednesday as California Congressmember Zoe Lofgren quoted a transcript of Capitol Police radio transmissions.
A radio broadcast was sent to all outside units. Attention, all units on the field were not looking for any pro-Trump in the crowd. We're only looking for any anti-pro-Trump who wants to start a fight.
Six Capitol Police officers have been suspended over their roles in the January 6 uprising, including an officer who posed for selfies with insurrectionists. In Russia, hundreds were arrested Wednesday as they took part in protests across the country in support of jailed nationalist opposition leader Alexei Navalny, who's hospitalized earlier this week as his health seriously deteriorated after starting a hunger strike in late March. He's believed to be in critical condition. In more news from Russia, President Vladimir Putin issued a warning to Western nations against intervening in national and regional issues, citing the situation in Belarus and Ukraine.
We really do not want to burn bridges, but if someone perceives our good intentions as indifference or weakness, and himself intends to finally burn or even blow up these bridges, then he should know that Russia's response will be asymmetrical, quick, and tough. But I hope that no one will think of crossing the so-called red line regarding Russia.
Human Rights Watch is calling on Thai authorities to release activists charged with insulting the monarchy and taking part in protests demanding democratic reforms. Two student activists have gone on hunger strike to protest their pretrial detention. Human Rights Watch said, quote, the Thai government should stop this witch hunt against peaceful dissenters and demonstrate respect for human rights by permitting all viewpoints. Back in the United States, the Senate confirmed Vinita Gupta to be Associate Attorney General Wednesday in a narrow 51-49 vote after Alaska Republican Senator Lisa Murkowski joined with Democrats. Gupta, a civil rights attorney, will be the first Indian American and first woman of color to assume the role. A U.S. judge has ordered the city of Los Angeles to shelter all unhoused residents of Skid Row. Judge David Carter said, quote, all of the rhetoric, promises, plans, and budgeting cannot obscure the shameful reality of this crisis, that year after year there are more homeless Angelenos, and year after year more homeless Angelenos die on the streets. The judge's order says all women and children on Skid Row need to be sheltered within 90 days, and every unhoused person in the area must have shelter by mid-October. Here in New York, the Manhattan District Attorney's Office announced it will stop prosecuting sex work and unlicensed massage. The DA is also dismissing over 5,000 cases of loitering connected to sex work, or what's commonly known as the walking while trans law, which was repealed earlier this year. Advocates welcomed the news, but said full decriminalization of sex work is still needed. And Senator Bernie Sanders and Congressmember Pramila Jayapal have introduced legislation that would tax Wall Street to pay for higher education. The bill would make community college free to all and would eliminate tuition and fees at public four-year colleges for families earning up to $125,000 annually. The costs would be offset by a one-half of 1% tax on stock trades and smaller taxes on bonds and derivatives trades. In a statement, Senator Sanders said, in the wealthiest country in the history of the world, a higher education should be a right for all, not a privilege for the few. If we're going to have the kind of standard of living that the American people deserve, we need to have the best educated workforce in the world. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman in New York City, joined by Democracy Now! Co-host Nermeen Sheikh. Hi, Nermeen.
Hi, Amy, and welcome to our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world.
Well, India is in a state of crisis as COVID cases surge and hospitals run out of oxygen. India recorded 315,000 new cases Thursday, the highest daily toll of any country since the start of the pandemic. India also recorded 2,100 deaths, India's highest daily death toll so far. Overall, its official death toll is about 185,000, but the true toll is believed to be far higher. Hospitals in New Delhi and other cities report they have run out of oxygen. Crematoriums have been overwhelmed with bodies. Despite this, India's Prime Minister, Narendra Modi, has continued to hold large campaign rallies. The phrase, Modi made disaster, has been trending on Twitter. Public health experts have blamed the surge on a number of factors, including the government's reluctance to impose new lockdowns, the spread of a double mutant variant of the virus, a recent Hindu festival attended by millions, and a slow vaccination drive. India's led efforts to force Big Pharma to waive patent rights on COVID vaccines, but the United States and other wealthy nations have blocked such a move at the World Trade Organization. In a moment, we're going to speak with a Texas doctor who's attempting to get cheap vaccines distributed to India and around the world. But right now, we go to Mumbai, where we're joined by the Indian journalist Rana Ayub. She's a global opinions writer for The Washington Post. First, we'd like to express our condolences, Rana, for your losses. You've had loved ones who've died from COVID-19 recently. You've described the situation as apocalyptic. So we're so sorry for your loss. If you can talk about what's happening in India, what's even happened to your family, and what accounts for this unprecedented surge in your country.
Thank you, Amy. Thank you for having me on your show, and thank you, for your wishes, and thank you, Narmeen. It is an apocalyptic situation in India right now. It's heartbreaking, not just to be a citizen of this country, but it's heartbreaking to be a journalist who is bearing witness to the events that are unfolding in India, especially with the number of COVID deaths that we are witnessing, and many of them in their early 30s. The two friends that I lost were in their mid-30s. Their families are still in the ICU. Yesterday, 22 patients lost their lives at one go in a hospital after a tank that was providing oxygen to the ventilators leaked for 30 minutes, and all 22 patients lost their lives in a span of an hour. And there is, I mean, it's like this country is breathless. On Twitter, in hospitals, whenever I'm going to report, everybody is begging for oxygen. As I'm talking, hospitals after hospitals in the national capital, not far from the Prime Minister's residence, are petitioning the High Court of the country to tell them that we have no oxygen left in our hospitals. State governments are accusing each other of oxygen theft, that they are stealing each other's oxygen tankers. It's that kind of a situation. An investigation done by a news website, Scroll, day before, suggested that the government of India had invested billions of rupees from the Prime Minister of the PM CARES Fund for setting up 162 oxygen plants. And so far, only 33 such plants have been functional in India. So clearly, we have not learned our lessons from the pandemic last year when a lockdown was announced and there was a migrant exodus. The situation in India right now is apocalyptic because the visuals are searing. I just wrote about the story of this young woman who was in her mid-30s, who had been wanting to have a child for 17 years. She gave birth to twin daughters, and within hours she died because she was COVID positive and there was no oxygen in the hospital. So that's the level of devastation that we are seeing. Patients, families are carrying their patients on hand carts and stretchers and carrying oxygen cylinders and begging for them on social media. And we're still talking about the privileged section, Amy. We're not even talking about rural India, from which there is so much underreporting, and we don't know how many deaths are being reported in rural India.
Rana, could you talk? You've said a little bit about why this latest wave is so devastating, but could it have been anticipated given the fact that the last, when the pandemic began in India, it was not as widespread? And can you talk in particular about the variant, the newest variant of COVID-19 that we know of, which originated in Maharashtra, in the state in which you are right now?
So Narmeen, the B.1.6.1 strain, which has been detected in India, in four different states, in Maharashtra, in West Bengal, is responsible for the higher rate of infections. This was first detected in October, and it's being linked to the higher rate of infection, but they're not very sure if it is linked to the severity of the cases. Experts in epidemics have told me that it is the reason that the infection is spreading at such a high rate. It is impacting a lot of young and middle-aged population, and which is why they're losing their lives. Now, the strain was first discovered in the month of October through genome sequencing of a sample in the country. Now, if the government of India had spent some resources and we had adequate genome sequencing, we could have possibly averted this situation. But that's the problem with this government. Despite the fact that we had a crucial year in 2020 when we lost so many lives, we slipped into this complacency. We had various cabinet ministers thanking Prime Minister for, in a way, eradicating the virus from India while it was still very much present. People were not wearing masks. Our clubs, our gymkhanas were open. People were walking on the streets without their masks. We were waiting for this to happen, plus for the fact that the government did nothing, learned no lessons from the fact that our hospitals, our healthcare infrastructure had collapsed. And despite that, and this was something that we discovered last year too, despite the fact our hospitals do not have enough intensive care units, beds, we do not have enough ventilators, the government has not had a great vaccination program rolled out. So I think everything coming together, this is criminal abdication of responsibility by the Indian government, not learning its lessons from 2020, which is why we have such a crisis of oxygen supply. We have a crisis of hospital beds. We have patients dying, and direct responsibilities, I think, is with the Prime Minister of this country, who completely abdicated his responsibility in a country of 1.3 billion people.
And can you say, Rana, what the response in the country has been to the fact that, in addition to what you point out as the failings of the Modi government, he has also himself held massive public rallies, even as cases have been going up? How have people in India, how are the media and others whom you're speaking to, how have they responded to what the Prime Minister has been doing?
Well, Narveen, I think last year the media was pretty proactive in calling the COVID virus the Talibanized virus in India, because some Muslims were a part of the religious congregation and there were barely 500 cases in India. This year, in the beginning of the year, in March, when there were millions of cases in India, the Prime Minister gave sanction to the Kumbh Mela, which is a Hindu religious festival where millions of Hindu devotees were in the north of India, taking dip in the Ganges, and that has been the single source of spreading the virus. And despite that, the Indian media is pretending that it did not exist. There's not a single critical report on the Kumbh Mela, which was sanctioned by the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister of the country has front-page advertisements in newspapers welcoming the Kumbh Mela devotees. As far as he himself is concerned, it looks like there are two different realities in India. One reality, which is also playing out on our social media, where people are begging each other and asking each other to amplify help for oxygen and hospital beds. There is another India where the Prime Minister and the Home Minister are holding massive rallies, massive election rallies, in which thousands of people are seen following him in road shows without wearing the mask. And the level of insensitivity which is being displayed by the Prime Minister, and the fact that no mainstream Indian media is still willing to question. They're talking about reports from hospitals. They're talking about deaths due to oxygen. They're talking about the distress in our crematoriums, that the number of deaths has gone up significantly higher, but none of them is naming the Prime Minister. None of them is questioning the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister is still to hold a single press conference to take a single question from the Indian media. So this complete abdication of responsibility, not just by the Prime Minister, but also by the Indian media, except for a few channels, except for a few independent publications who have stuck their neck out and reporting the truth. But the Prime Minister is pretty critical of those who are reporting the truth. And like I said, there are two realities. One India where the patients are dying and there is devastation on the streets. And one India where, as I talk right now, the Home Minister of India is conducting a roadshow with thousands of people.
The former king and queen of Nepal tested positive for COVID after attending the religious festival of Kumbh Mela in the northern Indian city of Haridwar, of course, which we know drew millions of pilgrims. If you, Rana, could talk about now the vaccines and the whole controversy around them, India stopping vaccine export because of the catastrophe, what's being called the COVID storm in India alone. In a moment, we're going to talk with Dr. Peter Hotez, who's at Baylor in Texas, working with an Indian company to get cheap vaccines distributed in India and around the world.
So, Amy, there is the Prime Minister likes to create a spectacle of everything, and that is also, he has not left the vaccine out of the spectacle that he has created. Initially, the Prime Minister went to the Serum Institute, which is located in Pune, which was producing Covishield, which is now being used widely, which has been used to vaccinate about 10% of the Indian population. But that is still not enough, and they have only been given one set of the two shots that needs to be given. As of today, the Prime Minister has announced that so far, only those above the age group of 45 were qualified to receive the vaccine. Now, those above the age of 18 are qualified. But the question that is being asked is, where are the vaccines? Why have we not upped our production? It took about the opposition leaders, various epidemic experts have been pointing to the Prime Minister that we should allow for the usage of various other international vaccines like Sputnik, and the permission was only given as recently as 10 days ago. That should have been done months ago. We still do not have enough vaccine. There is a war of words going on between the Prime Minister's cabinet, Prime Minister and his cabinet minister and opposition leaders saying that we don't have vaccines. And the Prime Minister said, well, we have given you vaccines. And in Maharashtra, where I am sitting right now in Mumbai, close to 67 vaccination centers, which were used to vaccine the elderly, have stopped because there are no vaccines. The Serum Institute, which is producing the largest number of Covishield vaccines, has given different set of rates for different states. So there is an inherent discrimination which is happening there. But then again, it's happening at the direction of the Prime Minister of the country, who has not even tried to calm the nerves of those in India who are apprehensive about the side effects of the vaccine. The Prime Minister of India and this health minister should have ideally taken a press conference or should have had large vaccination drives trying to make sure that people are not scared of taking the vaccine. That's what is happening right now. We either have no vaccines or in some places where we do have vaccines, there are people who are scared of taking it. So right now we have the Covishield, we have the Covaxin, which is being made by Bharat Biotech, and now we have Sputnik, which will be coming in India in the month of May.
We want to thank you, Rana Ayub, for joining us, Indian journalist, global opinions writer for The Washington Post. When we come back, we're going to speak with Dr. Peter Hotez. He's the head of vaccine development at Texas Children's Hospital. And we're going to talk about his push working with an Indian company to develop a low-cost COVID vaccine for the world. What would the U.S. government have to do with this? What did the U.S. government have to change about its policies around vaccines and exports? Stay with us. Say Your Prayers by Anushka Shankar, the daughter of Ravi Shankar. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Sign up for our daily news digest email by texting the word Democracy Now!, one word, no space, to 66866 today. This is Democracy Now!. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh. While India is facing a public health catastrophe from surging COVID-19 cases, the United States reached a milestone Wednesday, with the White House reporting it's reached its goal of administering 200 million vaccine doses within President Biden's first 100 days. He'd originally aimed for 100 million. This comes as the U.S. and other wealthy members of the World Trade Organization continue to fight efforts led by India to force Big Pharma to waive patent rights to help address the crisis. To talk more about the state of the pandemic in the United States and abroad, we're joined by Dr. Peter Hotez, co-director of the Center for Vaccine Development at Texas Children's Hospital, dean of the National School of Tropical Medicine at Baylor College of Medicine. He also has a new book out. It's called Preventing the Next Pandemic, Vaccine Diplomacy in a Time of Anti-Science. And he's part of a team at Baylor, which is working with a private Indian company to develop a low-cost COVID vaccine. Dr. Hotez, welcome back to Democracy Now! We just finished talking—
Thanks so much for having me.
It's great to have you. We just finished talking with Rana Ayoob, the Washington Post opinions editor in India, describing the COVID storm that they are experiencing there. You are coming up with a plan for a low-cost vaccine working with an Indian company. Can you explain what this means and what are the obstacles to it?
Yeah, and it's not only just for India. What we need is a simple, easy-to-use, low-cost, some people call it people's vaccine for the world, because the task is daunting. We have a 1.1 billion people in sub-Saharan Africa, roughly 650 million people in Latin America, at least, you know, close to half a billion or more in low-income areas of Asia. So you multiply that times two, we're talking about 5 billion doses of vaccine. And the question is, where do you get 5 billion doses of vaccine? You know, the mRNA technology is extremely exciting, but it's new. And whether or not you could ever scale it to that in time for this pandemic is really questionable. So what else can we come up with? There's the adenovirus vectored vaccines from AstraZeneca and J&J. There's going to be some issues around vaccine acceptance. Hopefully that will resolve. But in the meantime, we're trying to come through with something that uses the same old school technology as the recombinant hepatitis B vaccine that's been around for four decades. It's a microbial fermentation expressed recombinant protein in yeast, and it looks really good. It's finishing now phase two clinical trials in India and great protection in non-human primates, and now working with Biological E, one of the big private companies like Serum Institute of India, and they're based in Hyderabad. They're now scaling it up to a billion doses, and that's really exciting, and hopefully it could be released for emergency use authorization by this summer in India. But then what about the rest of the world? The Biological E is committed to, I think, providing about 70% of its vaccines to the COVAX sharing facility. But could we get another group to come along and help us with another 4 billion doses? And it would be great if the U.S. government could have a role in that and help reassert some leadership in global health.
Dr. Hotez, the Biological E vaccine is reportedly going to cost only $1.50 per dose. Could you talk about why it is some people have raised the question of why it is that a more accessible, cheaper vaccine that could easily be transported and stored, why such a vaccine was not invested in earlier, not developed earlier, and whether that could have happened with investment from rich countries?
Yeah, no, it's an important, you asked probably the most important question. And we asked it ourselves because we'd been developing coronavirus vaccines for the last 10 years. We work on vaccines for diseases of the poor, that vaccines that no one else will make. We have a vaccine for schistosomiasis in clinical trials. That's a huge problem in Africa, for Chagas disease in Latin America. And we adopted a coronavirus vaccine program 10 years ago because at that time nobody cared about coronavirus vaccines. It was also orphaned, and we figured out how to deliver the spike protein as a low-cost recombinant protein vaccine. And when we got the COVID-19 sequence in January, our team, which is just co-headed by myself and Mary Elena Batazzi, we've worked together for 20 years, we turned that around really quickly. And then we couldn't raise money for it because everybody was so focused on innovation. It was all about innovation, and they wanted mRNA and adenovirus vectored vaccines. And I said, that's great, but you know, what if you can't scale it, or what if there's a safety signal? Don't you want a simple low-cost vaccine as a backup? And we just couldn't get anybody to move. So I wound up raising money privately from philanthropies here in Texas, like the Clayburgh Foundation and Tito's Vodka of all places, and the JPB Foundation. They came through. I raised about $4 or $5 million, and then we were able to make that, scale up that vaccine and transfer it to Biological E. I often think, though, if I hadn't had to spend the first few months of the pandemic going out trying to raise money, we could have maybe had something ready to go right now. So, you know, I think I can't complain about the vaccines that we do have. I myself have gotten the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine, and I'm very grateful for it. But we, you know, there wasn't enough attention paid to an unfussy, simple, durable, easy breezy vaccine for resource poor countries, which is what we've been doing. And hopefully now we can move this along pretty quickly. Now, CEPI, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovation, is really helping Biological E. They're helping support the manufacturer, and I'm really grateful for that. And so we're trying to move as quickly as we can right now.
Dr. Hotez, could you also talk about some of the other constraints on developing and disseminating vaccines widely? The U.S. has also come under criticism, in addition to patent rights, for maintaining patent rights on these vaccines. It's also come under criticism for the ban that it's placed on exporting the raw material for vaccines. Could you talk about what exactly that ban entails and how it's impacting vaccine efforts around the world?
Well, I don't have a lot of details on the ban. One of the things I do know is the Biden administration, through the Quad meetings, I think was able to relax some of those constraints to support Biological E and allow some of those raw materials through. So I'm very happy that they did that. You know, the patent issue is one that I'm often asked about, and patents are important. One of the things I like to say, though, is, you know, the model of patent loosening patent restrictions was very much around small molecule drugs during the height of the HIV/AIDS pandemic, and you know, companies like Cipla, they needed the freedom to be able to make antiretroviral drugs, and patents are important for vaccines, but the most important aspect of vaccines is actually knowing how to make vaccines and knowing how to do it under a quality umbrella with quality control and batch production records, and also having adequate regulatory authorities and TAC. And that actually tends to be a bigger hurdle than the patent. So everybody, you know, focuses on the patents based on those earlier models for small molecule drugs. But the forces and the barriers that are around vaccines is a bit different. What we really need is to train human capital, people who know how to do vaccines under a quality umbrella and the national regulatory authority, and help with the capacity building. So the point is, even if you relaxed all of the patent restrictions for all the vaccines tomorrow, and I'm not certain how quickly that would translate into vaccines for the world for this pandemic. As a long-term issue, definitely it's important. But right now, I think we have to focus on one, making low-cost, easy-to-use, durable vaccines available to people in resource countries, as I say, 5 billion doses, number one. And number two, let's start working out that long process of building capacity. Right now, there are no vaccines made on the African continent, or essentially no vaccines. Not much better in Latin America, a little bit better, but not much. Same with the Middle East. And that's why in the Obama administration, I served as U.S. science envoy to help build up vaccine capacity for Muslim majority countries in the Middle East and North Africa. It was really exciting and to have the opportunity to do that. But we need to figure that out for the rest of the world. We're still too dependent on the multinational companies for something to filter down. And you know, a lot of the innovation right now in the vaccines is not even coming from the big three vaccine companies, Merck, GSK, and Sanofi. It's non-traditional organizations like Moderna and BioNTech and AstraZeneca, who are not vaccine companies, but are accelerating these new technologies. And it's really important. I think the innovation is really important. I just wish we'd had balanced the portfolio out a bit more with low-cost vaccines like ours.
Dr. Ashish Jha, who heads up the Brown School of Public Health, tweeted earlier today, India's in the throes of horrendous COVID surge. Horrendous. They're struggling to get more people vaccinated. We're sitting on 35 to 40 million doses of AstraZeneca vaccine Americans will never use. Can we please give or lend them to India, like maybe now? It'll help a lot, he said. I wanted to get your response to that, Dr. Hotez. Also, how much would it cost for the U.S. to invest? I mean, for God's sakes, the U.S. is pulling out of Afghanistan. There are many Congress members who are saying cut the Pentagon budget. You could take that money saved and pour it into vaccine development, ensuring vaccine equity in the world. So it's a two-part question, the AstraZeneca and how much money would it take for the U.S. to give the way it pours money into weapons development and sales?
Yeah. So, well, Ashish Jha is a good friend and colleague. He's a great man, and we talk quite a bit. And I didn't know he made that statement about the AstraZeneca vaccine, but I think he's right. There's no reason to hold on to it, and maybe there are other vaccine supplies that the U.S. can provide for India. But I think they should do that. But we should also remember the scale and scope of this problem right now. India, with a population of, 1.2 billion people, they're going to need 900 million to a billion doses to vaccinate their way out of this. So in some ways, it's a drop in the bucket. Yes, they should do it. But again, the real answer for the coming months is to help accelerate some vaccines like ours. As far as redirecting budget, you know, who knows how the Office of Management and Budget works in any administration, but the amount of funding that we would need to scale up production for another 4 billion doses, because remember, it's a high producing yeast strain, it's low cost. I think we could do it with a very modest budget. I talk a lot with my friend Jeffrey Sachs, who's an international development economist, and whenever I tell him about the money we need, he sort of rolls his eyes and he says, "Oh my God, this is a rounding error with the amount of dollars that you're talking about. It's so modest." And so if we can just mobilize some of that, I think it would be great.
Dr. Hotez, very quickly before we conclude, I'd like to ask you about a recent article you wrote for the BMJ Journal, saying that the high death toll from COVID-19 has not arisen from SARS-CoV-2 transmission alone, but also anti-science forces promoting defiance against vaccines. And you talk about the globalization of this anti-vaccine movement. Could you just explain what that is and how that's happened and how to counter it?
Yeah, unfortunately, the other hat I wear is a leader in going up against anti-science groups, not by choice, but sort of by default. Because in addition to being a vaccine scientist, I am the parent of four adult kids, and my youngest daughter, Rachel, has autism and intellectual disabilities. And a few years ago, I wrote a book called Vaccines Did Not Cause Rachel's Autism, which made me public enemy number one with the anti-vaccine groups. They call me now the OG villain, which I had to look up. It means original gangster villain. And now I'm what was sort of a fringe element, and you're seeing this play out nightly now on conservative news outlets. They're now a mainstream, and among the conservative parties in the U.S. are Republican Party, and that's really scary. And then you've got the Russian government launching an entire program of what's being called weaponized health communications, trying to discredit Western vaccines in favor of Sputnik V, and now this is globalized, and you're seeing the same kind of far right U.S. QAnon focus around the anti-vaccine movement now appearing in protests in Western European capitals. So I call this an anti-science empire. I tend to be a bit out there on this in the sense that there's not by any means consensus in the global community that it's reached that stage. But, you know, I'm of the opinion that when so many lives were lost in the United States, not only because of COVID-19, but of deliberate defiance to things like masks and social distancing. And now we have four independent news polls all pointing to the most vaccine hesitant group in the United States are what are being called Republicans. Some polls call it white Republicans. And that is the reality. There's been a politicization of the anti-science, anti-vaccine movement. And we have to figure out a way to dial it back, bring it back. I'm trying to reach out to conservative groups whenever I can, just because we've let this thing get out of hand. Neither the U.S. government or the United Nations agencies has really wanted to confront this and really call it out and, express concern to the Putin government and confront them on it, express concern in the U.S. about how we've allowed this to globalize. But we have to figure out a way to dial this back.
Dr. Peter Hotez, I want to thank you for being with us, co-director of the Center for Vaccine Development at Texas Children's Hospital. Congratulations on your new book, Preventing the Next Pandemic, Vaccine Diplomacy in a Time of Anti-Science. When we come back, it's Earth Day. We'll hear about the Red Deal. Stay with us. Journey Back Home by Charles Littleleaf. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh. Today is Earth Day. As President Joe Biden begins a two-day virtual Leaders Summit on Climate, a group of 101 Nobel laureates has published a letter urging them to, quote, keep fossil fuels in the ground and support a just transition to clean energy. This week, Congressmember Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and Senator Ed Markey reintroduced the Green New Deal resolution in the House with over 100 co-sponsors. This comes as indigenous leaders and land and water defenders have denounced the Army Corps of Engineers' decision not to shut down the Dakota Access Pipeline as it continues a second environmental review of the pipeline on Standing Rock Sioux land or adjacent land. This is a clip from a video message to President Biden produced by Standing Rock Sioux Tribe and the group Earth Justice in the Lakota language.
My name is Future. My mind remembers, but the heart feels it. It was the gathering of all directions. Standing Rock, 2016. That's where it all began. Thousands answered the call and came together to protect our river.
President Biden, you can be on the right side of history. Shut down the Dakota Access Pipeline.
More than two centuries of indigenous resistance led up to the movement at Standing Rock that proclaimed water is life. We spend the rest of the hour discussing this history and a vision for the future that's laid out in a new book published today titled The Red Deal, Indigenous Action to Save Our Earth. We're joined by two of the book's two dozen indigenous authors in Albuquerque. Melanie Yazzie is co-founder of The Red Nation, a grassroots indigenous liberation organization, chair of the board of directors for Red Media, an imprint of Common Notions. Red Deal is Red Media's first publication. Yazzie is a citizen of the Navajo Nation. She's Diné, assistant professor of Native American Studies and American Studies, University of New Mexico. We are also joined from Toronto by Uwahiki Maile, a Kanaka Maoli scholar and activist from Manawili, Oahu. He's also a member of the Red Nation, Assistant Professor of Indigenous Politics at the University of Toronto. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! Thank you so much for joining us. Melanie Yazzie, let's begin with you on this Earth Day. If you can talk about the Red Plan, the Red Deal.
Sure. So the Red Deal is essentially a people's program to prevent extinction. You know, we talk a lot in the Red Deal about, like, the plan is really clear. The stakes are really clear. It's decolonization or extinction. And the reason why we use the language of decolonization is because we draw centrally from Indigenous movements over the last couple of decades for decolonization. You know, Indigenous people have been on the front lines of the struggle for climate justice, you know, since 1492. But more recently, as the call for climate justice has been reverberating across the globe to address kind of this 29-year, right, clock towards climate disaster. You know, Indigenous people, whether it's at Standing Rock, the clip you just showed, Apache people fighting Resolution Copper, or Uauhekea's people fighting the 30-meter telescope in Hawaii. You know, Indigenous people have really been on the front lines of the struggle to advance the climate justice movement. And so we draw really centrally from that, and that's why we say decolonization or extinction. You know, and we can really trust Indigenous movements historically. So Indigenous people make up 5% of the world's population, but we protect 80% of the world's biodiversity, which, of course, is incredibly important when we're thinking about climate change and curbing climate change. And also something the Red Deal does, because we do claim that you can trust Indigenous movements because we've been on the front lines and we've been fighting this battle for so long, you know, is that we draw really centrally from Indigenous knowledge. And the way that we talk about Indigenous knowledge in relationship to climate justice is not the same way that we're often sort of cast or stereotyped in the mainstream environmental movement, which is often sort of a spiritual or a cultural window dressing, right, to the larger mainstream claims about climate justice and environmental justice. But for us, what constitutes Indigenous knowledge are actually Indigenous traditions of governance and science and technology that are really premised on caretaking our relations, right? So Vine Deloria Jr. once said that the crisis that we're facing as a species, as a globe, it's not actually climate change. He said, we've simply fallen out of right relation with the earth, right? We belong to a nation and a people who, instead of caretaking the earth and seeing the earth as a relative, we prey on the earth, right? We have a predatory relation. And so what we argue for in the Red Deal from an Indigenous perspective is that the reason why climate change is happening is because we have fallen out of right relation with the earth. And B, what we need to do to rectify the situation is to draw from Indigenous people's experience on the front lines of climate justice and really enter back into right relation with the earth. And we propose a couple of ways to do this. The first, and we draw really centrally from calls for abolition that are coming from the Black Lives Matter and the Movement for Black Lives movements, for the abolition of carceral institutions, right? The institutions that cause the most harm, prisons, police, the U.S. military. You know, Amy, you just said in the previous segment, you know, there are calls to reduce funding for the Pentagon, right, to pull out of Afghanistan. Why don't we take the money that goes into harming people and put it instead into reinvest it into that which gives people life and dignity? Healthcare, education, COVID-19 vaccines, infrastructure, transportation, right? Housing, those types of things. And so the Red Deal really talks about this from an abolitionist perspective. So we see that elevating the dignity of working class and poor people is really central to an Indigenous interpretation of climate justice from a decolonial perspective. And I'll just say one more thing. You know, something that and I'll talk a little bit more about this perhaps in the next few minutes, but something that we talk a lot about in the Red Deal is that when we were looking at the Green New Deal, which was the impetus for the Red Deal, we found that it was not comprehensive, perhaps, or extensive enough. It's quite a short document, at least the one that was introduced by Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. And in early 2019, we decided to sit down and think through what would it mean to indigenize the Green New Deal. And that's where the Red Deal was born. And for us, part of what that means is that we had to take a much stronger stance than the Green New Deal does on global imperialism, or U.S. imperialism and global capitalism, as the primary kind of philosophy of falling out of right relation with the earth. And so we really draw centrally from the Cochabamba agreement and the People's Gathering of 2011 in Bolivia, which had an explicitly anti-imperialist and anti-capitalist perspective on what Indigenous people are saying about climate justice. And so these are some of the things that are really at the heart of the Red Deal. It's an action-based program. Red Nation has always been a very action-based organization, and it's really meant for everybody to kind of dig in. There are multiple entry points, and it really embraces the diversity of tactics.
Professor Miley, if you could talk about, your book releasing today, which is when the Biden's climate summit begins. What are your expectations of this summit? Biden is being lauded for apparently he's expected to make unprecedented cuts, pledging to make unprecedented cuts, the U.S. cutting carbon emissions by over 50% by 2030. Your response to that, and what are your demands from the Biden administration? What needs to be done?
Thanks for that question. It's great to be on the show. You know, the Biden Climate Leader Summit isn't actually about climate leadership. We see it as a summit about climate imperialism. After the Trump administration pulled out of the Paris Treaty, the international community lost confidence in the U.S. as a leader in climate justice. After Obama signed on to the Paris Treaty and Trump exited, the Biden administration has a political obligation, let's say, not just to rejoin, but to attempt to assert leadership in the international community and secure its confidence. But even those within the alleged borders of the so-called United States are not confident. The Climate Leader Summit is less about climate justice and the international community, and more so about Biden's plan for reducing global warming, reducing greenhouse gas emissions, and committing funds to renewables. But as we know, and as the Climate Action Tracker suggests, the United States cannot assert itself and identify, be recognized even, as a leader in climate justice by reducing greenhouse gas emissions by 50% by the year 2030. It must be committed, according to the Climate Action Tracker, to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by more than 60%. And so what we see in the gathering of Biden's Climate Leaders Summit is a facile performance of U.S. imperialism that's dressed as American exceptionalism, masquerading as environmental justice. Even Biden's pointing fingers at China in his own version of xenophobia. The truth is that since 1750, the pre-industrial era, the U.S. has emitted 400 billion tons of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere compared to China's 200 billion tons. That's double the amount of China's emissions. Although Biden canceled the Keystone XL pipeline, he has yet to shut down the Dakota Access Pipeline, Enbridge's Line 3. We see within the so-called borders of the U.S. nation state that Biden's attempt to convene a climate leader summit is merely a symbolic performance that attempts to shore up American exceptionalism and the U.S.'s leadership internationally. And so we also see other nation states coming to the summit that are allegedly climate leaders when in fact they are on the ground, not recognized by people in this way. For example, Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, an alleged climate leader in the world that's been invited by President Biden, hopes to actually keep oil and gas pipelines flowing. Differently than Biden not canceling the Dakota Access Pipeline and Enbridge Line 3, Justin Trudeau actually purchased the pipeline, the Trans-Canada Mountain Pipeline. And since the pandemic has bailed out the oil and gas industry upwards of $20 billion during the COVID-19 pandemic. And so what we see in this Climate Leader Summit is that, like Biden, Trudeau isn't a climate leader. These are climate clowns that mime and perform the rhetoric and language of climate justice and environmental justice when, in fact, in material ways, are committed to extracting fossil fuels.
Professor Miley and Professor Yazzie, we're going to ask you to stay with us. And on this Earth Day, we're going to do a special post-show conversation that we'll post online at democracynow.org. I want to thank you both for being with us. And congratulations on your book, published today, The Red Deal, Indigenous Action to Save Our Earth. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.